acceptable in thy sight. For you are truly our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
If you would turn to the back of your program, I'm going to read the Acts reading this morning. And I'm going to read from 6, and I'm going to stop at 12. It says 6, so I'm going to stop at 12. And it reads as follows. When the apostles had come together, they asked Jesus, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up. And a cloud took him out of their sight. And while he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This is Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. They returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. Let's stop right there.
Amen.
And let us consider this morning the relevance of ascension. The relevance of ascension. On this seventh Sunday in the season of Easter, this is one of the texts that the lectionary has provided for preachers who preach from the lectionary to preach. It's the Sunday we remember the ascension of Jesus into the heavens. First of all, confession. As you know, you look at the back, you see the text, and usually you preach from any one of those. This was the one I least wanted to preach. In my few short years of preaching, however, I've come to realize that it is those passages that the preacher doesn't want to preach are often the passages that he or she should preach.
That's right.
For me, this text gives rise to what you've heard me refer to as the hermeneutic of suspicion. If we understand the word hermeneutic to be the discipline of interpreting biblical texts, and suspicion being a feeling of distrust or doubt because something has not been fully explained, then the hermeneutic of suspicion allows for my doubt to accompany my faith while engaging in biblical interpretation. I recognize the hermeneutic of suspicion could sound like blasphemy and disbelief for some. You know, if you want to be locked into the Bible says it, that's, I believe it, that settles it, you might have a problem with the hermeneutic of suspicion. It opens one charges to the charge by fundamentals of being a moral relativist. In other words, I sort of pick and choose what works. In other words, I have questions about this text. And I need to work out.
Right.
If Jesus has ascended, does that mean he's not with us today? Why do the disciples continue to look up?
Right.
And what does it have to do with what's going on in my life? See that's the question.
Right.
See, I always struggle to preach passages that cause me to question the relevance for our contemporary day. And on the surface, this one qualifies. Jesus cuts out. That's not working for me right now. What good is it to speak of ascension into the heavens to a people who, because of the absurdity of the human condition, find themselves spiraling downward in some form of spiritual hell right now? But know that without the hermeneutic of suspicion, there wouldn't be what we know today as a historical black church.
Right.
See, remember the history of the white preacher who was on retainer by the slave master, preaching to the slaves about the promise of a glorious afterlife in which they would be with this same Jesus that ascended in this morning's text, based on their years of service, loyalty, and brutality and long suffering on earth. Because that peculiar institution known as slavery is not something that appeals to me in the 21st century. And more importantly, it didn't appeal to a whole lot of slaves when they were getting that message. When you read the slave narratives, there are accounts of African slaves questioning the white preacher. One of my favorites, he said, the preaching we got taught nothing much. The white preacher would tell us to be good to our master, but we didn't care a bit more about that because we wanted to sing, pray, and serve God in our own way. Then the slaves said, you see, religion needs a little motion if you don't feel the spirit. So this white preacher, this message, we had to have a do-over. We got to go. I know we don't work from KC in the morning to KC at night, but we're gonna carve out some time. Go out in the bush harbor and have church again.
That's right.
Because that first one didn't take.
Okay.
That's the hermeneutic of suspicion. I got some questions.
Right.
See, and if there isn't freedom up in this heaven you're talking about, then the slave didn't want it. That is the suspicion right there. It's not so much disbelief, but rather it means I've got some questions.
Right.
I got some doubt. I got some uncertainty that somehow needs to be reconciled. And just taking things at face value is not enough. Everybody here got something right now. If you took it at face value, it wouldn't be enough. Everybody got something right now. You took it at face value, you couldn't make it till tomorrow.
That's right.
You got the hermeneutic suspicion whether you realize it or not.
Right.
I know it's not popular to admit, but if you read the Bible on a consistent basis, every now and then, you'll run into passages and cause you to say, I don't know about this. Judges 19 is a good example. You ever read Judges 19? You got a group of men come to the innkeeper's house. And say, that man, that guest of yours, we want to bring him out. We want to have sex with him. And the innkeeper says, no, he's a visitor. But here's this virgin girl. You can take her. Uh-oh, they cut her up into pieces. It's a hard one to preach. I've yet to preach Judges 19. Don't know if I ever will. It's a hard passage to take. Judges 19, it's in there. Read it sometime when you get there. It's in there.
Okay.
It is this doubt that prompted African slaves to steal away at night in order to have church in a way that was meaningful for them. This is why those contemporary discussions about church not being integrated, is overly simplistic. You remember saying the most segregated hours, 11 o'clock on Sunday? That's an overly simplistic analysis because they don't factor the sociology of religion, in the social structures, the practices, and the historical background of the people that all work together to make church meaningful. You're here this morning because your daddy said this. That's part of the reason you come. It's not just church. You can go to church anywhere.
Right.
There's a social and a communal aspect of church.
Right.
So that's why. What's always said is it's not always that simple. Worship has to be meaningful.
Right. All right.
And if it's not meaningful, there's no reason to attend. Therefore, my hermeneutic suspicion causes me to question the relevance of this text while I know that people have suffering going on in their lives. You got heartache. You got disappointment.
Come on.
And you need to hear there's a present help in the time of your trouble. In short, I cannot and will not preach about ascension if it cannot be realized for God's people. And I'm not going to preach something you got to wait till you die in order to realize. I need this text to be relevant right now for folks who are walking and breathing, catching hell right now. Moreover, ascension in and of itself carries a somewhat nebulous status. in the Christian tradition, there are two primary events that we acknowledge in the post-crucifixion narrative. One is resurrection, that's called Easter. And the other is the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descends. And we'll deal with that next week, but there's not a whole lot of talk in the Bible about ascension. There's not a lot of talk, but Paul, 1 Corinthians, is the first one to mention the resurrection, and the appearance of Jesus doesn't say anything about ascension. In fact, then there's more discussion about the day of Pentecost than we discuss next week. In this morning's text, the disciples were experiencing a number of defining moments that would shape their destiny. And you continue reading in the book of Acts. Their understanding of who they were and their future role was still in its infant stages. Jesus had already just been, not long, he had been crucified, he had been resurrected. You know, now they're sort of left with, what do we do with this? Well, where do we go from here? We thought it was all over. We thought, you know, it's all over. To this point, they were held together by a love, though, that was more powerful than the fear that overwhelmed them. It was not that long ago they thought that movement that they had signed up for was a miserable failure. Not that long ago they were hiding, fearing that they might be fugitives from justice. Some thought the women were lying when they said they had seen the Lord. Some left town and headed for a road toward the village of Emmaus. What had begun with such promise felt like it had come to a tragic end. What they did not know and what looked like their end was in fact God's beginning. Anybody ever have a situation like that? Where you thought it was the end only to find out it was God's beginning? Where you thought that it was all over only to find out that God was just getting started? When you believed you had hit rock bottom, finding out through those trials and tribulations, through heartache and hard knocks, let down some nonsense, God was actually the rock at the bottom keeping you up?
Come on, man. My Lord.
As the disciples spoke to the risen Lord, they asked, at this time, will you give the kingdom back to Israel? Still focused on that word kingdom as if it had political and military significance. Still focused on put us in charge, Jesus. That was not then, nor is it now, what Jesus' project is about, in spite of all the efforts over the centuries to portray it to the contrary. Jesus responded, I don't know what you're talking about, dude. Only God has the answer to that question. But very soon the Holy Spirit will fill you with power so that you will take my message to the ends of the earth. Is that not our charge today? Are we not charged to take that message to the ends of the earth? When he said this and they were watching, he was lifted up into the clouds and he was out of sight. After learning that their task would eventually encompass the world, disciples watched Jesus disappear from their midst. They would never see him again in the form they had grown accustomed. Then in verse 10, we are told that after Jesus' ascension did not stop them from looking steadfastly toward heaven. Being a follower of Jesus, there is always a temptation to sometimes have our heads in the clouds. As they remained standing there, transfixed, two spirit beings appeared to them and said, Galileans, why are you standing here looking up in the sky? I understand since the days of the early Christians, followers of Jesus have looked toward the heavens because they believed Jesus was there, but the mistake they made, and I dare say it's one that we can be susceptible to as well, is thinking that Jesus would return the same way that he left. But those who have watched the skies looking for Jesus will invariably be disappointed. Watching the skies becomes an excuse for inaction. A reason to stay stuck. Looking to the heavens is to want God to do for us what we ought to be doing for ourselves. The charge that the disciples received in this text is the same charge that the church has today.